Hello, my friends, and welcome to a new episode of It's All For You, Demon, where we celebrate the magic and TG&Y glory of KISS. And today, we go back to a time in history when this man captured the world's attention and KISS released a disco record. Dynasty, all to the merge, and the KISS Army Sponge, here we go.
So in 1979, marketed as the return of KISS, the band released their 11th studio solo record, not taking into account the live records or the greatest hits. This was the band's 11th studio record, and this was their return to being a full-fledged band after the release of the solo albums in September of 1978. And although history has shown us that this record is truly not a complete band lineup studio record, and the fact that Peter only played on one track, we're going to disregard that, and today we're just going to focus on the impact this record had on the time, on the band, and on the fans. Looking back, I can imagine the divide that this album and direction of the music would have taken fans in 1979. I wasn't a KISS fan in 1979, but I'm just trying to compare kind of the same scenario I went through as a kid. When I was little, I loved Van Halen. Van Halen was everything to me. When Van Halen got a new singer, things kind of got scary, but then 5150 was an amazing record, and when Van Halen released OU812, the direction they took musically, a lot of it was keyboard driven and piano, and it was kind of a departure. So I think, in a way, it was the same kind of departure KISS did with this record, going for more of a disco poppy sound. So had I been a kid in 1979 and remembering how I was when Van Halen released OU812, I still was on board with Van Halen. So I think putting myself in a fan's shoes in 1979, I still would have been a KISS fan with the release of Dynasty. Had I been a 9-year-old kid in 1979, I think I still would have been on board. And knowing everything I love about this record today makes me agree even more. I would have been on board as a kid in 1979 with the release of this record. This record is the first record to feature more Ace Frehley tracks than have ever appeared on an actual KISS record. Ace actually trumps Gene with the number of tracks on a KISS record. With this release, Ace actually ties Paul with number of songs appearing on the record. I know we can say 2000 Man's a cover, it's not really an Ace song, but I think Ace really made that song his own. Gene only brings in two tracks, which is very odd. That had to be a strange shift in the dynamic of the band, that Ace really, I think with the success of his solo record, Ace really came to the table as a full-fledged force in the KISS camp. Now, I love everything about this record. I love the disco pop songs. I love the overproduction of the disco sound. I love Ace's songs. I love the one Peter song. This would be the one record if I was to go to a desert island and I could only take one album from the band, this would be the album I chose. I love everything about this record. I love the aesthetic of the cover. I love the disco excess of the sleeve. I love the inclusion of the four colors of the band members as defined on the solo albums, brought to life in this glittery logo. I love everything about this record. This record was a first for many things, and one of them being the inclusion of a full band poster. This was the first album that included a full band poster, and it was a poster of the picture that appears on the center ring of the album. And this is the first record to include a center ring picture that actually extends the entire ring. Kiss began putting pictures on these center rings with the release of Love Gun, which is strange that they didn't do it with Rock and Roll Over, as that album art would have played perfectly with a center ring design. It's kind of strange that the band began doing extra, even more cool stuff with this record, as that trend would only continue for one more record. And then things slightly went downhill. And I think one of the reasons I am most fond of this album is the excess of the disco era. I love the glittery excess of disco, and nothing says it better to me than this sleeve. This sleeve is my all-time favorite album sleeve from the band, and nothing says the fun of this record quite like the France 45 for I Was Made for Loving You. It's got this gorgeous glittery silver cover. For some reason it has 78 solo shot photos, but the beauty of this is right there. Disco rock. That, to me, that is pure TG&Y fun. Nothing is more fun than those two words together. That's amazing. The merchandise form for the album also showed the excess of the Kiss machine at the time, and in the fact that this is the first merch form to actually come in a book type design, where the consumer would open it and peruse actually like a magazine, as well as some of the merchandise available for the Dynasty record, also was different than merch offered in prior album. Some of the merch that was available was things that you would actually pick up in a store, but you could order instead from the Kiss Army warehouse, like the makeup kit, the jacket, super space age fabric. Books were available, the diary, the Phantom of the Park book, the 78 tour book, and the Dynasty tour book. Probably the coolest thing of this merchandise form, however, is a boy or girl could enter for a chance to win the brand new Bally 1978 pinball machine. I think what makes this most interesting for me is to enter this contest, fans would have to take a photograph of themselves made up as a member of Kiss. So out there somewhere exist tons of photos of children from the 1970s, and adults probably, dressed up as members of the band. How cool would it be to run across those photos? You could make a coffee table book out of that. I'm sure a lot of hard work went into designing outfits. A lot of Kiss makeup kits were probably purchased, and kids entered to win the grand prize, a pinball machine from Bally. I wonder who won it. I wonder if they're out there. I wonder if they still have it, or where it ended up. How cool would it be to actually run across and find and play the Kiss pinball machine that was won from the Dynasty merch form? That kind of stuff I love to think about. I love to daydream That kind of stuff blows my mind. Lastly, one of the main and for sure reasons why I love this album so much is the fact that in 1979 for Kiss, on top of their game, everything was bigger and better and larger than life, and nothing said that more than the tour for this record and the outfits that were designed for this tour. Just the boldness of these outfits are so cool to me, and then I can see why this would draw a rift between the band's fans. Older teenage fans would see this as cheesy and childish, but young kids, myself included in 1979, I was 5. Had I been a Kiss fan, I would have been completely on board and enjoying every moment of this space age comic book trip. So cool. Now, the Dynasty tour was very over the top. The budget for the tour was extremely high. It was the highest of any Kiss tour. The effects for the tour, for the first time, Gene flew. There was even talk in the Kiss Alive Forever complete touring history book by Kurt Gooch and Jeff Suze that there was talk that there would be a moment in the concert where a spaceship would land and tiny Martian creatures would come out and Gene would fight them with his axe bait, which of course was scrapped. But can you imagine how amazingly cool that would be? But that also goes to show that the band was truly marketing towards children at the time. But had you been a kid in the audience in 1979 at one of these Dynasty shows, there was a moment in the show towards the end where the giant disco ball in the center of the arena would open up and out would fly the funnest thing of the Dynasty era, the Kiss Army Sponge. If you've ever seen bootleg footage of the Dynasty Largo show, there's a moment where you see the disco ball open up and you begin to see the emergence of the sponges, and they would fly out into the audience during the Kiss confetti downpour of Rock and Roll All Night. Such a genius idea. I can't even imagine the frenzy of children trying to grab one of these sponges. So cool that, you know, they weren't for sale in the merch forms. You had to be a lucky one to grab one at the event. A lot of the reason I love this tour, everything was bigger and better and crazier, and there was really no limits to the imagination of the band. They were truly on top of their popularity game, and they were just a sci-fi fantasy comic book escape rock and roll band. Sadly, it wouldn't last. This would be the last colored merchandise form ever included in a record. And this would be the last big American tour of that makeup era. Well, there you have the magic, fun, and glory of the disco era of our favorite band. I hope you have enjoyed this stroll through memory lane back to a time when disco ruled the airwaves and Kiss was larger than life. Thank you for watching. Hope to talk to you again. Take care. Be safe. She's got the magic touch.
Crazy.